Okay. I myself, I'm not very actively developing at the moment anymore. I'm more working on the architecture side. I have been working for Accenture for almost 20 years and in total have IT experience of a bit more than 20. And I'm involved at the moment in project or more program actually. And one of our large clients in the area of their global public websites. So a lot of what I'm going to talk about today has practical impact and is related to what we're doing there. And to start, I thought it would make sense to start with a look at what a monolith actually is. No? And even without looking at a very technical description, just looking at what the Oxford Dictionary is saying about it, it's a large impersonal structure regarded as indivisible and slow to change. And especially the slow to change part nowadays, where every company tries to be more agile, tries to get shorter times to market, and so on, is, well, potentially a rather problematic thing. Just in general, I just kind of sketched it as a three-layer architecture style thing here on the right, and I'm going to keep that picture on the next couple slides to show changes that are typically made and how those reflect there. Monoliths are often, existing systems that have grown over a long time, and they are hard to change, as I already said. They are rarely wanted, but actually in exceptional cases, that might be just the thing you want to do. They are often not enough modularized to easily maintain them, especially with, if the size grows, you need more people, you need to break down the people in multiple teams. And if the areas of responsibility are not clear enough and so on, maintenance becomes much more difficult. And on the more technical side, systems that are monolithic and not modular enough are also hard to scale. And that's aspects that often become difficult. Backend side, over the last years, microservices have been a popular architecture pattern to target that problem and to try to solve that. So either breaking down existing monoliths in smaller pieces and trying to operate those better, or when building new systems, initially trying to build those as microservice-based systems. So at the end, what you typically try to do there is try to, if I switch back, the backend and the database part, try to break down the backend part in smaller manageable systems with a specific purpose. And to do that, you often use a domain-driven approach so that there's no functional overlap between these and that they can operate independently. And when they can operate independently, you can also develop them independently. And you get more, independence, less dependencies between the different teams maintaining or also operating them. And typically for microservices, it is said to have a separate database per microservice as well. So the image considerably changes already. And on the lower two levels, at least, you get better manageable chunks, pieces. And having those and combining those with, in the microservice environment, typically the ability to scale horizontally. So when load increases and a single instance of the service is not able to handle that anymore, you just add additional instances and have a load balancer in front of that and you can scale almost indefinitely. To be honest, that brings a lot of new complexities as well, because operating that environment and managing interactions between microservices that are possible in principle absolutely allowed, but the whole environment you have to manage then becomes more complex. So additional new things to cover, but that's not today's topic. You've probably already noticed, but there's one area in here that I am, well, remained a big block, and that's the front end part. That does not necessarily have to be an issue, but as many front ends in the last years have become so-called single page applications, so pages that are not just HTML anymore, but including more and more JavaScript, becoming full-blown applications that without having to reload a page incorporate much more functionality in there, and what you do much more things in those become bigger and bigger and bigger. So we've seen front-end applications, single-page applications that at the end have become monolithic themselves. With all the problems we've seen before back-end side occurring on the front-end side. The applications grow, you need more people to do that, you have multiple teams to manage that, and you start getting dependencies and problems really delivering in time and what you need. So what can we do to address that, and how can that be handled? Can that be broken down as well? That's something I just want to have a quick look at. But you could come up with approaches where you try to split the applications during implementation time or build time or deployment time, whatever. That typically doesn't really help because you still have the dependencies until the deployment. So what you really want to achieve is separating front-end parts in a way that you can also separately deploy them and separately run them. But then the integration of the multiple applications into one consistent experience needs to happen during runtime. A very, let's say, blunt approach to that would be to just have like multiple single-page applications and switch from one to one application to the other application just by using a traditional link in an HTML page. You know? I have a couple of examples here that most of you might know. So one is from Office 365, the other is from Google. They even have like a widget with the links where they list the multiple applications, and basically whenever you switch from one application to the other, you get a full page reload, you switch the page, and the new application starts. No? In that context, it's hard to hand over any state or context data or whatever from one application to the other. And after having created that slide, I actually started thinking that's probably even the inverse approach. Yeah, that's not trying to split down an existing monolith in separate pieces. That's more like trying to unify multiple monoliths under one experience or something like that. Yeah? So that's actually not really what we want to achieve. Back and forth. That's the right slide. So what we actually want to do is, instead of having one single big single page application, break the content down, the content of one page, break that down into probably also static parts, but incorporating multiple applications into a single page. And the image also illustrates it a bit. Nowadays, every application needs to be responsive and needs to support different types of devices. And so the required flexibility for that should be part of the solution as well. So again, how can we do that? One approach, I'm curious what reactions I will get, might be to use iframes. That's more or less the expected reaction. first bullet already says it, the iframes have a very bad reputation. Part of that is actually valid. Yeah, traditionally, there have been a lot of issues with iframes, and there have also been security issues, and they are not that flexible. And they can be rather slow, because even if you would have libraries or frameworks like React or whatever, if you would use that on the incorporating page as well as in multiple of your frameworks, each of them would have to load the full resources, no? Which is not really optimal, which makes it slow, and so on. On the other hand, there might actually be occasions where you can profit from some features of iframes, and iframes have actually also improved a bit over the last years. So nowadays you can use much more sandboxing features on that, and you can have more control over how open or closed, let's say, the iframe and its usage is. So there are use cases where it's actually beneficial to have an iframe, because it can be very isolated as well. But yeah, well, as the reaction already shows, it's hard to have your front-end developers to accept that, and that's also not really the way we wanted to go. So another approach that nowadays you might say is very obvious to use for that is web components. Anybody here actively using web components? Okay, so I'm curious what you will say. Because I have to admit, I don't have practical experience with web components, but I still do have a bit of an opinion on that. Web components are kind of a new standard that came up over the last years. And you can potentially use them to visualize parts of a page, but if you look at, I come to that again, but if you look at everything you need to dynamically load feature apps, multiple apps on a single page, have those interact with each other and stuff like that, web components alone will not be the full solution. So you will still need something else on top of that. The same is actually, I don't have a separate slide for that, but the same is actually true if you would say, oh, then I use React and React modules to achieve that, or any other framework. At the end, it's not a complete solution yet. So a rather new approach to that is micro frontends. That's a term that came up a couple of years ago, and that is an approach to, how did it put it here, to think about a website or web app as a composition of features which are owned by independent teams. Features is typically used as the term for describing a special functionality or something that a web application should offer. You know, probably you are also familiar with the term of feature toggles, which are used to switch on or off such functionalities. I have it linked here as well. The page microfrontends.org is probably one of the more interesting reads on the topic itself. So feel free to have a look at that. Well, after the talk, obviously, not now. And the term itself, I don't know if, does anyone know the tech radar of ThoughtWorks? No, just a couple. That's, I would recommend that as well. Twice a year, I think, they publish a new version of it, and they assess upcoming technologies and new technologies, and they try to give recommendations on those, short explanations what they are, recommendations if it's something worth looking at, trying, or actually something they strongly recommend actively using. Because there's so much technologies, they can't keep up with continuously monitoring everything. So sometimes technologies drop out of their radar just because they don't have the time to maintain that. But the term micro frontends appeared there like in 2016 and has since then, well, continuously been growing in importance. On the project that I am at, that I mentioned, we started looking at the topic early 2018, I would say. And yeah, I'll come back to that in a minute as well. So, micro frontends. The image somehow stays more or less the same. I only always exchanged the title in those orange boxes. So, as the definition already said, the goal here is to achieve breaking down a page in individual chunks that can be developed, maintained, tested, run, whatever, by small and manageable teams, and have those independent as much as possible. I'm just saying specific issues here at the moment. I'll get back to that in a second. But the thing is, for the additional aspects I mentioned, with integrating that and dynamic loading those, having them communicate, actually also micro frontends alone not necessarily solve all of those. Yeah? And at the time we were looking at that, there were also no really established frameworks yet that you can use for that. Okay, it's the other way around, but doesn't matter. So to better understand that, I'd like to quickly compare the micro frontends with the, well, traditional single page applications. Actually the other way around. So single page applications first. And as obvious as it may be, such a single page application has full control of the page. Full stop. Yeah? Sounds obvious. Is probably obvious, but that's not true anymore when you have micro frontends. Yeah? They have to share the page space, let's put it like that, the screen space and all the environment. They have to share the context of the browser. And there are functionalities of a browser that are not really prepared to get shared, or where a traditional single page application very obviously can assume that it just alone can consume that. So an easy example, for instance, would be often when you work with a single page application and then you click around in there and get to different subparts of whatever, the application uses the history API to change the URL you see. Yeah? So you can use that to bookmark stuff as well and use it for deep links and so on. As soon as you have multiple applications on the page, the URL is also often used to store the state. No? If you have multiple pages on the page, each of them having their own state, which of them would be the right one to change the URL? If they do it intermittently, you just end up having chaos and can't consistently store any state in there. So either micro frontends need to be aware of the others and need to be considerate and, well, look out for each other and be careful, or they need some help. And to achieve that, within the mentioned project, we are closely working together with Sina Schrader, which you might not have heard here about in Slovakia, but it's a company that Accenture bought that's mostly based out of Germany, and which is now part of Accenture Interactive. And well, they have a couple of quite clever guys, and they came up with a new self-built framework called Feature Hub, inspired by the term feature that is being used for the front-end development stuff. And luckily, we have a very open-minded client there, and he actually suggested himself to open source that, and well, sooner or later get feedback and other contributors, and just be able to share that as well. I've put here the two main relevant links for that. FeatureHub.io is, well, the web page that also contains explanatory text and documentation on that. So if you'd be interested in the framework, a good read as well. And open sourced, source needs to be available, so you can find that on GitHub. And that framework, well, is supposed to support all the aspects I've already, probably most of them already listed before. And on top of that, the idea was to not, well, just only support a single technology like web components, like React, but to come up with a framework that is able to support multiple of them, even on the same page. That is able to support sharing state between multiple of those applications, or put a bit simpler, to be able to exchange data between them. And one aspect that was also very important at our client is that it should be able to support server-side rendering, which, you guys correct me if I'm wrong, but web components at the moment are, well, server-side rendering is at least difficult to do for those. Or maybe I need to quickly explain server-side rendering. Is used to speed up the so-called first page load. So instead of having the client load HTML and JavaScript and then trigger a whole host of individual backend calls, then incorporate the data that comes back and render the front end, you try to do a lot of that server-side already. And incorporate that in the HTML that you then deliver to the client. No? And then you need the client to pick up where the server-side rendering left and have the application run from there. Especially for mobile devices, something you can gain considerable performance improvements with. Yeah, the feature hub itself works with a couple of different components. Most obviously, probably, something called feature apps. That's in the feature hub environment, that's the micro front end. So that's actually the application you want to put in a part of the page. In relation to supporting multiple technologies, there's two modes of feature apps that's being supported by the feature app. That's the React feature app or a DOM feature app, which basically covers everything else besides React. And something that is strongly encouraged is to use namespacing for the feature apps to better isolate them and avoid conflicts in that area. I'll try to give an example as well. I mean, the question comes up, what is then a typical UI element, something you would use a web component or a React module for, and when would you actually try making that a feature app? No? As long as it's pure UI functionality, I don't know, a calendar widget, for instance, you know, just showing a nice calendar, enabling you to select a date, and at the end only returning a single date value, I personally would probably say that's a UI element. Use React, use web components, whatever, for that. As soon as you have additional functionality, real JavaScript code, that some business functionality, whatever, that goes beyond that, then it should probably become a feature app. Or to use another example, you probably all know those picture carousels, yeah, where you can load multiple pictures in, and they either automatically or when you click on them get shown. As long as when you create a page, you statically configure, I want to have those 5 pictures. Yeah, you put that there, the page loads it and only shows those 5 pictures. That's probably, well, the carousel itself is just a UI element. When you have interaction with a backend and do service calls to determine which pictures do you need to show based on other criteria, based on dropdowns used on the page, stuff like that, then it very probably could make sense to make a feature app out of that. So, yeah, technically speaking, there's also a couple of things that a feature app needs to fulfill. So you need to provide an object that actually defines the feature app, that needs to provide an ID that can list dependencies to another component of the feature app I'll come to in a minute. And most importantly, it needs to define a create function. So that's more or less the entry point then for the framework to include the app on the page. So just to complete that in code, that could look as simple as this. So we have an ID at the top. We have a so-called feature service as a dependency. We can define externals. That's like, well, has similarities with shared libraries, let's say. No? So if multiple feature apps define the same React version as an external, the page all in all only needs to load it once, which would, of course, save a lot of bandwidth and can be beneficial for performance as well. And at the end, just a function stub here, the create method. The second bunch of components is, well, basically the feature hub itself, so the integration framework being used. And that has 3 main components itself. So it's the feature service registry, where so-called feature services can be managed and be made available for the apps as consumers. That's the feature app manager, which is responsible to manage the life cycle of the feature apps on the page. So most importantly, loading the feature apps, and utilizes so-called feature app loaders to achieve that. And depending on what packaging or modularization concept you use for your feature apps, you might require customized feature app loaders. There's a couple one provided, but you are free to adapt that to your own needs as well. Again, we have a couple of technical aspects here. So the feature hub to make that work, it needs to first instantiate the feature app registry. It needs to register all services that are available on that page. It then needs to set up the feature app manager and, finally place the feature apps you need on the page. In code, that's rather simple again. So we need to import the corresponding modules and missed that comment. Because it's always tedious to do those steps again and again, the colleagues actually came up with a single function that does it all in all, the create feature app. And the feature app loader that I mentioned, to be able to load a feature app, needs a couple parameters to do that. It needs to define a feature app ID, which uniquely identifies the feature app within the page. Doing that properly, you could even have multiple instances of the same feature app on this on one page, but showing different aspects, different states, whatever. A URL from where to load the bundles of the feature app. If needed, feature app specific CSS, and also if needed, you can hand in some configuration parameters. Again, in code, on that high level, not really very complex. And the last part, the last components, that's a bit like the glue between the feature apps, are so-called feature services. And those now are meant to enable the feature apps to communicate with each other, to exchange dates, to exchange data, but only to a certain extent. So the base idea here is to have the pieces of state that are managed by a single feature service to have that small and compact, and only have a very simple setter and getter interface for that. And then you have like a subscription mechanism for the feature apps. So each feature app can register for a feature service and will then get notified for any state changes happening there. So if one feature app uses one of the setters of the feature service, that will trigger a notification to all the others, and those are then free to use the getters to check for the changes. And there's well, a couple of groups of different use cases to do that. One is what I just basically already described, is exchanging state, exchanging data between the feature apps. The other one addresses a relevant part of well, those issues that I had mentioned before, like who is actually the right app to change the URL of a page, no? As no single feature app can decide or determine that by itself, a good approach could be to use a service to do that. No, sorry, a feature service to do that. So it kind of abstracts away the transparently takes over that coordinating aspect. No? Each feature server, a feature app, instead of using directly the history API, would communicate with a history feature app, for a history feature service, for instance, and that then can include different mechanisms to determine what the URL needs to look like, and then manage the URL, and can in the other way around can already can also be used to, well, for deep linking when you get such a composed URL, to get all feature apps back in the state that they were supposed to be on that page. Then there's also a possibility to use that for sharing configuration. Now, sometimes you dynamically need to load some configuration for a page, and can use that to distribute the relevant parts to feature apps. There's one thing that that's important here as well. The main intention here was is that communication with the backend is always being done by the feature applications. So feature applications call backend services, get data from the backend, and only when they need to exchange data at all, you need a feature service or should create a feature service. But a feature service itself should not be a proxy to backend services. That's not the intention of feature services. So, and again, there's a couple of technical aspects here. We need, again, for every feature service to provide an ID. We can have dependencies to other feature services here, for instance, as well, and also need a create method, which has a special aspect here. Feature services can also cover multiple versions of their API, of their interface over time. And we would do that programmatically within the single feature service and use SEMVER style versioning for that. So that the feature app and the feature services can do dependency checks, can determine if there's multiple feature apps requiring different versions of a feature service, so that all of that can be managed. And in code, that might look very familiar, actually, because it's almost exactly the same as we had for the feature app. So the mentioned ID, the dependencies, and the create function. So When we now bring all of that together, the picture on the right shows all the components and actually also shows that we could integrate it with other JavaScript, with other more or less static content, whatever, to compose a full page out of that. And enable those to, well, talk to each other as well. There's a couple other aspects for the framework that are probably worth mentioning. At our client, we are mostly using React at the moment. So that's where we are coming from. That's like probably the best supported framework at the moment. But in principle, the feature hub is capable of working with multiple frameworks, be it web components, be it Angular, whatever. It can obviously dynamically load feature apps. It actually even supports using feature apps within feature apps, which at first sight is something you might wonder about. What would you need that for? But we have special use cases where a feature app dynamically determines, for instance, depending on which user is logged in, which other feature apps needs to be shown to them. And then can dynamically determine which feature apps get dynamically loaded afterwards. And of course, mentioned before, server-side rendering is relevant here. And And we have a couple of standard feature services that are provided with the framework directly, so which you would not have to develop on your own. One is the history feature app, history feature service. Sorry, the wording can be a bit confusing, but has its purposes. The history feature service, as described, to manage the URL of a page. A logging feature service that helps to aggregate logging from multiple feature apps. And actually a bunch of feature services that support the server-side rendering part. And we are almost close to the end, but there's one thing that's probably important. And I was surprised that Mark was already using that statement actually during his keynote this morning. But yeah, with great power comes great responsibility, has already proven true here as well. Actually, similar to microservices backend side, when you use a framework like that, there's new complexities you need to manage. And the feature hub as framework actually gives you technically a lot of flexibility, and there's a lot of stuff you can do, but you probably shouldn't. So, although it does support multiple technologies, for instance, if you start combining, 3, 5, 10 feature apps on a single application, and each of them brings its own framework it uses. One is Vue.js, one is React, one is Angular, whatever. Each of those frameworks need to be loaded themselves as well. And that would make a page quickly huge and slow to load. So in some cases, you might not be able to fully avoid that. But a strong recommendation here would also be to have the teams for different feature apps ideally agree on the same technology, like all of them using React. Keep the complexity in that aspect a bit lower. The other thing is actually quite interesting is that it could also be interesting to combine the very first approach I was showing, the URL-based integration of multiple applications, to use that here to integrate multiple contexts you might need. You might have one set of feature apps that are loaded with one page, and you might have a different context where you need a different set of feature apps. And to switch between those, you use URLs again. So you have multiple levels on how to manage how many feature apps end up in a single page as well. And for microservices backend side, there's already a whole ecosystem that has evolved and that helps you manage those complexities and helps you improve communication between microservices and so on. For micro front ends, that's all still very new. That's all stuff you still need to have a good look at yourself. And well, that's basically it. Do you have any questions?
Traditionally, this approach of separating everything into multiple separate front ends was longer time, and it uses building frameworks like Webpack and so on, assist and create this stuff. Is that feature hub somehow dependent bundling framework?
Yes and no. Partially, that's what I mentioned on one of the slides earlier. That's more or less integration at build time. Now we are trying to focus here on integration during runtime. And the yes and no is yes, it can work with Webpack, and it can also work with alternatives. That's why you can have different application loaders, but it does not require those. Anything else? Yeah. Technically, you can. Practically, you would probably end up having longer load times. So you should try to avoid that. But if you really have independent teams, they might not all be releasing at the same time, and you might not be able to coordinate updating to a new React version at the exact same time. But as I said, the framework is able to work with multiple versions of React at the same time, yeah. He was quicker.
Does this framework also support? I want to hide it. Navigation bar. One part of the feature.
Yeah, that's what I mentioned before. If you properly handle the ID thing, you can actually use multiple instances of the same feature app on the same page. So that could be one thing, that you have like the maximized app and the minimized app, two instances of the same app. Or you could actually think about splitting that into two different feature apps. Yeah? One showing the actual chat and the other only the notifications. You could create a feature service for that.
Okay.
All the better. That was a bit difficult to hear, but I understood you want to know how do you make a feature app listen to a feature service. Yeah, that would be the classic event bus thing. The feature service actually simplifies that a bit. So you still kind of register to a feature service to get those notifications, but then the feature service only offers a very simple getter and setter interface. I think I mentioned that before. So one feature app simply sets a property in the feature service. Then the feature service notifies all registered feature apps, and they can then basically decide themselves if they use the getters to check what has changed, or use the changed state then. We can talk about that afterwards as well, maybe. Oh, we're already over time, so that had to be the last question. Thank you.